प्रणव सर,
यस मैम। ओके
यस वी कैन स्टार्ट नाउ।
थैंक यू मैम। अ वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल। आई एम प्रणव चिपलगट्टी ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ जेएसपीएम्स राजर्षि शाहू कॉलेज ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इलेक्ट्रॉनिक्स एंड टेलीकम्युनिकेशन हार्टिली वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर द सेकेंड सेशन ऑफ डे 10 ऑफ 2 weeks faculty development program on artificial intelligence and its applications in biomedical engineering. Today we have with us an eminent speaker, Dr. K.K. Mishra sir, to deliver a session on topic binary genetic algorithm, its applications and classification. I heartily welcome you sir on behalf of ENTC department. I feel extremely honored to introduce him today. Dr. K.K. Mishra is presently working as an assistant professor in Department of Computer Science and Engineering MNNIT Allahabad Prayagraj. He has successfully organized around 6 IEEE conferences in India, IEEE-T series as conference secretary and worked as a program chair for many other conferences. He has worked as PC members for many conferences in India and abroad and has successfully organized some special issues in highly indexed journals. He is a regular reviewer of Journal of Supercomputing, Springer, Applied Intelligence, Applied Soft Computing, IEEE Transactional Cybernetics, IEEE System Journal, Neural Computing and Applications, and also in IETE journals. In addition of it, he has reviewed many publications for SCI and Scopus Index Journal. We are fortunate to have you with us today. I welcome you once again and request you to start the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Pranav, for such a nice introduction. First of all, I just want to thanks the organizing team members of the program because they have invited me for the talk. Thank you very much. And my talk will be on artificial intelligence because the topic is artificial intelligence. And we will discuss on one application of artificial intelligence. Actually, we will talk about one artificial intelligence technique that is called as binary GA. And I will discuss the binary GA classification. So, although, because this program is on AI, so you have heard many things about AI, but this is the definition which I want to share with you. What is AI? So artificial intelligence is a branch of computer science which deals in designing smart machines which are capable to do those tasks which requires human intelligence. Actually, there are two kinds of problems, one which can be easily solved by the computer and one which can be easily handled by the human beings. For example, if you want to perform computation, so computation problem will be very easy for the computer, but it will not be easy for the human being because of the hardware, you can say the hardware which is available for operation. For example, in computer, we use BLSI or LSI chips, which are very good in solving computation related problems. But in human being, we have cells, so that cell system will not support computation. So there are some problems in which this artificially designed systems are not good. For example, if you want to recognize the face of a particular person, that problem will not be easy for the system. So we want to solve those problems which are very easy for the human being, but which were typical for the computer. For those, we want to write programs. So we have to define some techniques so that the machine can understand like how that problem can be solved. So those techniques are called as AI techniques. So first we have to see what kind of problems requires human intelligence. And then we will see how can we design the solution of those problems. So furthermore, AI techniques are used to solve those problems by computer, which can be easily solved by the human being. I have already discussed. Solution of such problems require implementation of human intelligence in computer program. So because we want to solve those problems which are very easy for a human being. So in fact, what we have to do, we have to check how human behaves while solving a particular problem. So that behavior has to be implemented in the form of computer program. So we will talk about those things like how can we map human intelligence in the form of computer program. So but before that, we have to understand the difference between computer and a human. So a computer was invented to speed up arithmetic calculation and data processing. It was not created for replacing human being. So earlier it was invented because we want to speed up the calculations. So we have never created the computer for replacing human being, means we don't want to use computer for replacing the human task, human labor. But now what we are doing actually, we want to replace the human being. So its hardware and software has certain limitations. So we are talking about computer, and these were designed to process data efficiently. It can assist in solving those problems whose solution can be represented by mathematical models. So what is the problem with the computer? If you want to solve any problem with the help of computer, what you have to do, you have to design a mathematical model. And who will design the mathematical model? Definitely the human will design that mathematical model. So mathematical model will define like what instruction we have to execute, how those instructions will be executed. So these things will be defined by the human being. So computer, what computer does actually, it simply processes the mathematical model and it gives you the solution. So in absence of any mathematical model, computer cannot solve problems. So when you have simple problems, you know, in every computer, we are using some kind of programming language. So why we are using the programming language? Because there are so many instructions which are already inbuilt. So whatever problem we want to solve, what we have to do actually, we have to write instructions so that we can identify the solution of the problem within the given set. Given set means whatever is available in our programming language, on the basis of those instructions, we will try to formulate the solution of the problem. What will happen if you don't know the solution of the problem? So in such problems, what you have to do, you have to create a model, and you need a human being for creating that model. And that model will give you the approximate solution. So that kind of thing is called as implementing heuristic kind of approaches. So how human intelligence can be implemented in the computer program? So if you want to solve those problems which are very easy for a human being, what you have to do? You have to apply the human intelligence in the form of computer program. So how human intelligence can be implemented? So if you want to implement human intelligence in computer program, these three activities you have to automate. So first, if you want to solve any problem, okay, first you have to create the mathematical model. So human intelligence is required to convert this problem into mathematical model. So if you can automatically create a model, then you can do it easily. So there your intelligence will be required. Sometimes it might be possible that for a given problem, there might be several set of solutions. So human intelligence is required to identify which solution is producing the best value. So if you want to replace the intelligence, then you have to provide some program which can identify the best solution in minimum time. And you can see one more thing which comes under human intelligence is adaptability according to environmental conditions. So let us suppose if you want to make your program adaptive, you have to use some sensors. You have to sense the environmental condition, and according to the environmental condition, you can change the program outputs. So what kind of problems requires human intelligence, like where we can apply artificial intelligence related programs? So there are four kind of problems where we can apply the artificial intelligence related programs. So first problems are called as optimization problems. optimization problems are those problems where we want to identify minimum or maximum value of certain objective function. So those problems are actually typical problems. So you, if you want to design simple algorithms, those algorithms will not work. So you have to apply some kind of intelligent approach. So that's why artificial intelligence methods are required to solve optimization problems. Second kind of problems which we want to solve using AI techniques are prediction problems. Sometimes you will find that some data set is given, some data input is given, and some data output is given, but no relationship is known to you. So what do you have to do? You have to, in that problem, you have to predict some value at unknown instance. So for example, let me explain this. Let us suppose this is the pen. Okay. So let us suppose this is X value, this is Y value. This is X is equal to 1, 2, Y is 1, 4. Let us suppose we want to identify what will be the value of Y at X is equal to 3. So these problems, even though these problems looks very easy, but it is not that easy to solve certain problems. So these problems are called as prediction problem, because here certain data is given to you. And on the basis of that data, you have to frame a mathematical model, which can give you the correct output on the given input value. So some data set is already given to you. You have to apply some mathematical modeling technique and you have to give the answer. So what is typical in this problem? Actually, you can provide many mathematical model which can provide the accurate, which can provide a solution of this problem. But out of those models, which will be the optimal one? So that is a complex problem. Again, it is related to optimization. Third kind of problems which you can solve is related to expert systems. Sometimes you have to replace the expertise of a particular human being. So if, in that case, you can design expert systems. So you will store some data values over there and you will define some inference engine. So that is called as expert system. So we are not talking about expert systems. I am simply concerned on optimization problem, and we will talk about the application of optimization algorithm on prediction problem. One other area where we can apply artificial intelligence approaches is natural language processing. So what is natural language processing actually? What you want to do with the help of natural language processing, because we people speak English, Hindi, or whatever language we know. So that language is called as natural language. And the machine can understand only machine related language, machine level language. So how will you establish communication between the human being and machine? So that is the part of natural language processing. Okay, so I have collected several problems from several areas of engineering. So for example, there are several applications of optimization problems. Some of them belongs to electrical engineering. So if you want to solve, for example, economical load dispatch problem, you can go for optimization problems. That is the kind of optimization problem you have to design the solution. If you want to talk about mechanical engineering, there is something which is related to rotary furnace, which you can optimize. In management, you can go for the portfolio optimization problems. It is a very important problem these days. So if you are interested in share, and if you want to minimize your loss, then you have to design your portfolio accordingly. So that is a very good problem. In electronics, you can go for signal related things, and you can design some optimization problems related to signal processing. What are the application of prediction related problems? So in electrical engineering, you can forecast load. In mechanical engineering, you can go for supply chain system. In management, you can define stock market prediction. So again, this is something which is related to money. So that is a beautiful and interesting problem. and how the expert system can be designed, like where the expert system can be designed. So in electrical engineering, you can go for smart grid designing. In mechanical engineering, you can design smart supply chain. So wherever you are replacing the need of expert, you can go for the expert system. Management, smart portfolio management system. Similarly, NLP. So NLP is always related to like how you are establishing communication between machine and human being. Anyway, so these are the application areas. So what are the artificial intelligence related problems and where we can apply the artificial intelligence methods we have already seen. So now we will see how can we solve optimization problems. So there are several algorithms actually, because I have already discussed that optimization algorithm or optimization problems are artificial intelligence related problems. So we first we need to see why those problems requires human intelligence. Okay, what is there in that which makes them typical, and then we will see how can we solve such kind of problems. So optimization problems are those problems where we want to optimize certain objective function. So let us suppose, let me show you something. Okay. Let us suppose this is the problem. This is fx is equal to sine x. This is the very simple problem. And the value of x is in between 0 to 3. And we want to identify the maximum value of this fx. This is a example of optimization problem. Now, before checking like why we should go for binary genetic algorithm, why we cannot work with the traditional program method, traditional programs, we have to understand the type of the problem. So what we want to do here, you can see this is the optimization problem. So here you can see this is the objective function. Objective function is what? So I have already written fx is equal to sine x. So it means we want to identify the maximum value of this sine x. So this is our objective function. And max means I want to identify the maximum value of this sine x. Where? So this is called a search space. So in between 0 to 3, you have to identify the optimal solution which will produce maximum value of this sine x. So this problem looks very simple. But why this problem is typical? So let us talk about the solution of the problem. How can we define the solution of this problem? So solution is, one best solution is you have to differentiate this function and make it zero. So simply write dy by dx. So this will be cos x. Then that mathematical method you can apply. And on the basis of mathematical mathematical method, you can identify which value of x will be producing the best value. But unfortunately, because you want to solve this problem using your computer, that method cannot be implemented. The reason is, you don't know how to write the program for dy by dx, for implementing dy by dx. So how should we solve this problem? So the only method is, because here you can see, this is the search space. So you have to consider each and every value between 0 to 3. So you have to ask yourself, is your computer handle these continuous values? So because you have seen many problems, like if you want to sort these numbers like 1, 4, 2, 3, your computer can handle. Why? Because only 4 values we have to arrange in proper order. But how many values? So computer can handle only discrete number of values. It cannot handle continuous values. So here you can see the search space is continuous where you want to identify the optimal solution. So that region is continuous. So this will create the problem, and this will make your problem complex. So such kind of problems where the input is continuous, the problem are called as NP-hard problems. NP-hard means you cannot write an algorithm. You cannot write an algorithm which can check each and every input and give you the best solution of the problem. So NP-hard means non-polynomial, means there exists no polynomial algorithm which can provide the solution of the problem in finite time. So because the search space is continuous, so how can you solve the problem? What methods are available? So although the one very basic method is, because you are working with 0 to 3 and you want to identify which value is producing maximum value of sine x. So definitely you cannot work with the continuous search space. So what you have to do? First, you have to divide your search space. This is your search space into some fixed number of points. So that is required because computer can handle only discrete number of points. It cannot handle continuous values. So after division, you have to calculate the value of each and every solution. And then on those values, you can identify the value of sine x. And the value which is producing maximum value of sine x will be the best solution. So let us suppose if I have taken four solutions. So first thing, I will try to calculate what will be the actual value of those four solutions. And then I will calculate the value of sine x for each and every solution. And because I want to identify the which solution is producing maximum value, I will need around 8 number of comparison, and I can tell you like which solution is producing the maximum value. But the problem is, will this method give you the exact solution? Definitely no. Because here you are taking very less number of solutions. You are dividing your search space in very less number of solutions. So whatever answer you are obtaining will not be the accurate one. So how can we improve the accuracy of the solution? So if we want to improve the accuracy of solution, we have to increase the number of points in the search space. So in place of four, if we take, let us suppose 32 number of solutions. So definitely we can, again, we have to find out what will be the value of those 32 solutions. Again, we have to calculate what will be the value of sine x on those 32 solutions. Then we have to identify which solution is producing the maximum value. Will it give you the exact global optimal solution? Again, definitely not, because you are taking only 32 solutions. So if you want to capture the global optimal solution, what method you have to adopt? You have to divide this search space into more number of solutions. But what will happen when you divide this search space into more number of solutions? When you divide it into more number of solutions, the complexity of the problem starts increasing. It increases actually. So let us suppose, at what level of division we can expect that we could get the optimal solution. So we need around 2 to the power 20 number of solutions in between 0 to 3 for the identification of nearly global optimal solution. So 2 to the power 20 is not a less number, you know. So first you have to divide your search space into 2 to the power 20 number of solutions. Then what you have to do? You have to calculate the accurate value of each and every solution. Then you have to calculate sine x value of each and every solution. So that process will not be easy. That's why such problems are called as NP complete problems. So I hope you can understand this. So what is the problem actually? What if I told you that if you divide, So I told you that yes. if you divide this such a space into 2 to the power 20 number of solutions, then you can you will be able to identify an answer which will be very close to your exact answer. But we cannot write a algorithm, deterministic algorithm, in which we can calculate accurate value of all 2 to the power 20 solutions, and then we could calculate. Yeah, I think somebody has some question. Devendra, would you like to ask any question? Hello.
I think it is by mistake. We'll take the question answer session at the end of the talk.
Okay. It's fine. Right. Thank you. No problem. Thank you. So what I'm talking about, yeah. So I was talking like, if you are working with a deterministic algorithm, and if you have divided your search space into 2 to the power 20 solutions, then you cannot write a deterministic program. The reason is you have to identify the correct values of all the solutions. Then you have to calculate the value of sine x for each and every solution. Then you will be able to identify which solution will be producing the optimal value. So what to do in that case? In fact, we want to solve such kind of problems. So writing deterministic algorithm is not possible, but what you can do actually, in place of deterministic algorithm, you can go for the randomized algorithm. So randomized algorithm will provide nearly same answer with very less number of evaluations. Okay. So genetic algorithm is a randomized algorithm which can provide you a very close answer to the global optimal one. So I'm not going into a randomized algorithm. I'm assuming that many of you are aware about this how can you design randomized algorithm, and what is the difference between deterministic algorithm and randomized algorithm? So let us talk about genetic algorithm. So genetic algorithm is a randomized algorithm. So we apply nearly the same process which we have used in implementing deterministic algorithm, but in with slight difference actually. So we will try to frame some operators, okay, and we will try to identify the global optimal solution, but we have to use some methods which will be different from the deterministic method. So the first idea is why GA? So GA can be used to solve optimization problem. GA means genetic algorithm. It is called as genetic algorithm because the theory of this algorithm was inspired from the theory of natural selection and evolution. So that theory is related to genetic learning. So that's why this is called as genetic algorithm. It is called as genetic algorithm because the whole program implements the theory of natural selection and evolution. So natural selection and evolution, why GA programs implement the theory of natural selection and evolution? Because it provides an alternate to solve optimization problem. This theory states, means which theory? I am talking about natural selection and evolution. That all species produce their offsprings by participating in natural selection and evolution process. So there is a theory which was given by Charles Darwin. It is a biological theory. So that says that at some time, let us suppose at some time T, we are having some set of species, then there will be some kind of selection, crossover and mutation, and they will produce offsprings. So what was the important finding of the theory? The important finding was the theory that the fitness of offspring population will be better than the parent population. So what does it mean? So what we are doing actually, let us suppose this is my, come on, this is parent population, so it will go for selection, crossover and mutation, and it will generate offspring population. So what will happen when you apply this selection, crossover and mutation one number of times, you will get a new solution whose fitness will be more than the previous one. So what is happening actually, we are not doing anything. We are simply using selection, crossover and mutation, and we are getting new solutions which are more fit as compared to the previous one. So when we apply this process again and again, at one iteration, we will be able to get a solution which will be able to produce the maximum value of the solution. Maximum value of the solution. So that is what we want. So that's why we are using this theory. Okay. What is important in this phenomena? Idea which says offspring will have higher fitness as compared to parents. So how we implement this theory? Okay, so the idea is because the parent offspring will have higher fitness as compared to parent. So when we repeat this process again and again, we will be able to identify the global optimal solution. So that's why we are implementing this phenomena. So how we implement this theory in our computer program? So we will try to create same environment and we will try to design the same operators which was there in biological theory. Okay. So I told you that what we have discussed in genetic algorithm theory, you will choose one parent population, then you will apply selection, crossover and mutation, and you will generate child population. So what the first thing is, you have to create parent population. How will you create the parent population? So that I'm going to show you. So I'm talking about the binary genetic algorithm. So binary genetic algorithm is what? Actually, there are several types of genetic algorithm. And one type is binary genetic algorithm. When we represent our solution by a binary number, then the version which was created for implementing GA is called as binary genetic algorithm. So how we start with the binary GA? So we start with the search space. We have seen that we want to solve that problem where the value of X is in between 0 to 3. So that is called as search space. So our first thing will be, we have to divide this search space into 2 to the power n number of solutions. Why? Because we want to represent each solution by a binary number. So we can do it by dividing this search space into 16, 32, 1024 number of solutions. So why we are dividing it into 2 to the power n number of solutions? The reason is we want to represent each solution by some number of binary bits. So for example, if we are dividing it by 16 number of solutions, then each solution can be represented by 4 bit. If we are dividing it by into 10, 24 solutions, then each solution can be represented by 10 bit. So that's why we are dividing it. So this is the first step. So after dividing such a space into 2 to the power n number of solution, each solution can be represented by a n bit binary number. So that is a simple thing. So let us take an example. If we divide search space into 16 solutions, first solution will be 0000 and last one will be 1111. So I hope there will be no problem in this. So first step in binary genetic algorithm. So in first step of GA, parent population, okay. I told you that you have to apply the same phenomena in the form of computer program. So parent population is created. See, in most of the problems, size of initial population is 50. Because I'm talking about a toy problem, I'm telling you with very small problem. So here, I will start with only 4 solutions. So this is called as initial population is what? Means how many solutions you are taking in initial number of, as a parent population. Parent population means how many solutions you are including in first set. So in general, when you are solving some problems, complex problem, the population size you have to take is 50. But because I'm explaining this problem with a simple method where I have already divided my search space into only 60 number of solution, what I will do, I will take the size of parent population as 4. Only 4 solution I will take as a parent population. So let us suppose, so what I will do, I will choose a randomizer and I will generate 4 solutions randomly. So for example, I told you that when I divide my search space into 60 number of solutions, first solution will be 0000 and last solution will be 1111. So I will use a randomizer and I will randomly generate 4 number of solutions. So this is the first step. This will be the first step of binary genetic algorithm, right? Now we have created the parent population. So now we have to apply selection, crossover and mutation, and we need to generate the offspring population. Okay, so next step will be, so how we apply selection, crossover and mutation. So before that, we have to evaluate these solutions. Evaluate means we have to identify the fitness values of these solutions. So whatever function you want to optimize, you need to see what will be the value of those solutions. So how you can do that actually? First, you have to convert these solution into the correct or into the accurate value of the solution. So that can be done by using this formula. This is the formula which will convert your binary value into the actual value. So this is the formula. Look, x actual means if you want to identify the actual value of a given binary string, then you have to take minimum value x min x max 2 to the power n minus 1 and decimal value of x binary. I will show one example. So let us assume that input domain is 0,3. So this is your x min, this is your x max. And the number of points we are taking 64. So it means we want to represent each solution by, so that is called as 2 to the power n. How many solution we are taking? So that is 64. So how can we identify this value, accurate value of 010101? The process is very simple. So you have to start with the x minimum. So it will be 0 plus 3 minus 0. 3 is x maximum minus 0 divided by 64 minus 1 into the decimal value of this solution. So that is 21. So when you apply everything, it will give you the 1. So this will refer, like when you, if you are writing some value, like for example, in this case, 010101 in the form of binary, what will be the actual value of this one? In the given search space, the actual value will be 1. So this formula can be used for the identification of actual value. Let us take another example. So we can take another example. So here we are taking, this solution is represented by 4 bits. So it means total number of solution would be 16. So we can apply the same solution, same method, and we can identify the actual value of this solution. So once these binary values are converted into actual values, okay, then you can identify the value of sine x or whatever function you want to optimize, you can identify the objective value. So actually, whatever algorithm you are designing, whether you are working with the binary genetic algorithm or there are several other algorithms like particle swarm optimization, differential evolution algorithm, actually any optimization algorithm works with 2 things. First, you have to identify the good solutions. Like first you have to generate initial population. From the initial population, you have to identify the fitness of each and every solution. So why we are doing that one? Because we want to identify out of those given solutions, which solutions are good and which solutions are not good. So how can we identify which solutions are good and which solutions are not good? So that identification can be done on the basis of fitness function. So the solution which are having good fitness will be the good solutions. The solutions which are not having good values will not be good. So why we are interested in the identification of good solutions? Because it gives you the idea like where your optimal solution might be. So for example, if you have already spotted one good solution, okay, then you can apply this process, which is called as exploitation and exploration. Exploitation is what? If you have a good solution, if you search nearby solutions around that already generated good solutions, there might be some very good probability that you will be able to identify another good solution in that area. So that is called as exploitation. But exploitation means what? You have already identified one good solutions and then you are exploiting the search space. Exploiting means you are searching nearby solutions in the hope that you could identify another good solution. But only exploitation is not sufficient. Sometimes exploitation, when you exploit the region, you will definitely identify good solutions, but that good solution will give you the local optimal solution, not the global optimal solution. So you have to combine two approaches. One is called as exploitation and exploration. So in addition to exploiting the area, or in addition to exploiting the area, you have to perform exploration as well. So why we are performing exploration? We are performing exploration because we want to identify other areas where other optimal, other good solution may lie. So this is how we create any optimization algorithm. So we have already discussed like how we have initialized our population. We have already seen how can we convert those values into actual values. Now we will see how we can apply selection, crossover, and mutation. So this is about exploitation and exploration. So we generally, what we do, we apply crossover operator for in binary genetic algorithm, we apply two operator for exploitation and exploration. One is called as crossover and other one is called as mutation. And for selecting solutions, like which solution is good and which solution is bad, we use selection operator. Sorry. So let us suppose if this is the fitness, these are the four solutions. So after calculating the accurate value of these solutions, we will calculate the value of sine x. Let us suppose the value of sine x in this case is, it is 0.3, 0.5, 0.7 and 0.4. So we can apply one selection operator. There are several selection operator which can be applied. So what selection will do actually, selection will discard worst population, worst solution from this initial pool and create multiple copies of good solution. So when you compare, actually you will find that these two solutions are having good values because it is 0.7, it is 0.5. And this 0.3, 0.4, they are not having good values. So what selection does, actually, it will create multiple copies of 1000, 1000, right? And 0100 and 0100. And it will remove these two values. So this is the general method of selecting values. So you can apply so many selection, so many selection operators are there. So you can apply tournament selection. You can go for proportionate selection operator. So many selection operators are there. So after selection, you have to apply the crossover and mutation. So crossover and mutation is used for exploiting the search space. So let us see, we have already applied selection. So this is what we have selected, right? So what does it mean? It means 10000 is a good solution. 01000 is a good solution. So how can we perform exploitation? So exploitation means if you search nearby 1000, you may find some other good solution. So what is nearby to 1000? So definitely a solution with 1001 will be nearby to 1000. Similarly, the solution 0111 will be nearby to solution 1000. So that is called as exploitation. But in genetic algorithm, we exploit the things differently. Okay. Because we don't know like what value we have to add in the previous value. So we, if we are adding one value, we will get this one. If we are adding two step size, we will get 1010. So how we do that? Actually, we randomly select two solutions. For example, 1000 and 0100, these two solutions. And you can see this is 0th bit, this is first bit, this is second bit, this is third bit. And what we do, we use a randomizer and we choose a cut point. So what cut point does actually, a cut point will give you, it is a method of actually appending the lower half of second solution with the upper half. So in this way, you can create 1100. The new child will be 1100. And here, the new child will be 0000. So in one crossover operation, you can create two values immediately, right? So that is the beauty of crossover operator. So generally, we don't want to apply crossover over all the solutions because definitely in reality, actually, when you talk about human being, it is very difficult to see. You will find many cases which are where you will find that people are not married. So definitely the crossover probability means how many people can perform crossover operation. So there is a probability associated with it. So you have to see what was the size of initial population and you have to multiply with the crossover probability. So that will give you means how many times you have to apply the crossover operator. So if the crossover probability is 0.5 and if the size of initial population is 4, you have to apply crossover operator 2 number of times, right? Similarly, there is a probability which is associated with mutation. So mutation, again, we have to do the same thing. And on the basis of those values, we have to apply the crossover operation. So there are several kind of crossover. So I have already discussed one point crossover. One point crossover means I will randomly select two solutions, pick one cut point, and I will cut these solutions into two pieces like this one. Let us suppose if we want to perform crossover of these two solutions, I have to define a cut point, then I will cut it. Then first part of first solution will be appended with the second part of the second solution. Similarly, we have to append the second thing. So new solutions 1111 will be generated and 00000 will be generated. Now the question is, after performing one crossover, two parents are involved and two new solutions you are generating. Now, what to do with these two new solutions? What will happen? So in classical genetic algorithm, classical means there are several versions of genetic algorithm. In classical genetic algorithm, what we do actually, we simply replace the parent values with the children value, like without checking whether the newly generated values are good or bad, we are simply replacing the parent values with the corresponding children values, offspring values. So this, when we apply this method one number of time, this is one application of crossover operation. If you want to apply crossover operation two number of times, again, you have to check the new population and you have to apply the crossover operator again. There are some other operators. So this is the example, like how can we perform the one point crossover. There are other crossover as well. Two-point crossover, uniform crossover, so many crossovers are defined. So this is what will happen when your cut point will be near to the least significant bit, you will be performing exploration. Just a minute. Exploitation. When your cut point will be near to most significant bit, you will be performing exploration. So this is how. So if somebody is saying, What is the purpose of crossover? And if you are saying that crossover is used for exploiting the search space, your answer is not correct. Crossover can be used both for implementing exploitation and exploration. It depends on the cut point. Similarly, so this is one more example. So this is the intermediate population after the crossover. So then we apply mutation. So mutation is also simple. So after crossover, you will check one and you can pick any solution. Okay, and then you have to identify, you have to choose any bit randomly and you have to simply invert it. So that is the, that is called as mutation operation. So for example, it will be 011011. So this is what we implement in the mutation. So after crossover mutation, selection crossover and mutation, you will get offspring population. Okay. So this will complete one iteration of your application of selection crossover and mutation. So starting from the parent population, you have created one offspring population, right? So now you have, again, you apply selection crossover and mutation and go for the new offspring population. And you will repeat this process again and again until you get your optimal solution. So this is how we implement binary genetic algorithm. So this is, algorithm is very popular in solving optimization problems. But it has several applications also. It can be used in solving classification related problems. So I will be talking about how binary genetic algorithm can be applied in solving classification related problems. So wait a minute, I'm just calling you. Hello? Hello? Yeah, sorry, actually, yeah, there was a phone call. So this was the idea behind genetic algorithm. So how genetic algorithm can be applied. Now, where you can apply this genetic algorithm, what are the application of binary genetic algorithm? And there are several questions like, is it guaranteed to obtain optimal solution? So there is no guarantee that GA will provide you optimal solution, right? But in fact, it can give you some guarantee that it will give you a very good solution anyway. So now we will talk about one very good application of binary GA. So binary GA can be used for solving classification problems. Classification problems are those problems where some data set is given to you. And for a unknown input value, you have to identify the correct class. So that is called as classification problem. It is a part of this machine learning problems. So how we do that? So I'm explaining it. So this is the example, right? This is the example. This is very common example of classification problem. So here you can see there are 14 number of data instances and some features are there. On the basis of those features, you have to identify the class, correct class. So you can see actually what the person is doing. Actually, he is collecting some parameters related to the day, like what is the outlook, what is the temperature, what is the humidity, what is the wind? And on the basis of those things, he will be deciding whether he can go for playing tennis or not. So he has collected 14 data items for 14 days. Now we want to create an algorithm which can correctly classify these solutions. Classify means when you provide sunny, hot, high, and big, it will be able to provide you correct answer, no. Okay. So how can we do that? So that can be done on the basis of binary genetic algorithm. So what we have to do, look. So what we have to do actually, we have to provide the solution of this problem in the form of hypothesis. We generally provide a solution of the problem, and solution of this problem is known as hypothesis. So in binary genetic algorithm, the solution, the hypothesis will be written in the form of 1 0 1 0 1 0, because you know in binary GA everything has to be represented in the form of binary, right? So we will try to form a generalized hypothesis which can satisfy maximum number of instances. So how that can be done? So for representing each hypothesis, what we are doing actually, we will identify different solutions of the same problem. So a hypothesis will give you one solution of the problem. Let us suppose if I'm saying currently the features are sunny, hot, high and big. So what will be the, how many solutions are following this hypothesis? Sunny, hot, high, big, no. So definitely this is only one data set which is following this hypothesis, right? Hypothesis means the conditions. So this will be the hypothesis of our, this will be one hypothesis. And what will be the fitness value of this hypothesis? So when we write this hypothesis, we will get only one, like only one value will be true out of these 14 values. So the fitness of this hypothesis will be 1/14. Now we are looking for a hypothesis which can generate the correct solution for fitting all these 14 instances. So how could we do that? So let us suppose I'm giving you another hypothesis. Another hypothesis is, if I'm saying, okay, if my outlook is sunny and my answer is yes, play tennis is yes. So how many solution will satisfy this hypothesis? If my outlook is sunny and play tennis is yes. So you can see in this hypothesis, we have omitted the value of temperature, humidity and wind. So what does it mean? It means we are only concerned with this outlook parameter and this play tennis parameter. We are not worried about these values. Temperature, humidity, wind, they can take any values. So when we represent these solutions by a binary GA, so all these values, actually we are not worried about these values. So we make those variables as don't care, right? So what is my hypothesis? If outlook is sunny, then play tennis will be yes. Look, if outlook is sunny, play tennis is no. So this is not satisfying this value. If so, outlook is sunny, no. If sunny, yes. If sunny, yes. And any other value for sunny. So I think two values are there, what I can see. So, okay. So when I write this hypothesis, if outlook is sunny, and then play tennis is yes. So now this hypothesis will have fitness 2/14, right? So we will start with some hypothesis, some random hypothesis. Okay. And we will generate binary strings, because in binary GA, we have to represent each solution by a binary number, right? And then we, again, once we have started these values, we can calculate the fitness of these solutions. After calculating the fitness of the solution, we will start like selection, crossover and mutation. We will generate new hypothesis and we will check like whether those hypotheses are covering more number of solutions or not. So definitely, because GA can generate a hypothesis later on, GA can generate a hypothesis which can cover more number of solutions. So you will be able to identify the solution, best solution of the problem. So how hypothesis is represented in binary GA? So for representing hypothesis, this is you can see we will write each and every parameter. So this is outlook, this is temperature, this is humidity, wind, and then plate tennis. Always remember that two kinds of parameters are there. One is called as input parameter and second one is called as output parameter. So what you need to see, how many values, how many attribute values this outlook can take. So this outlook can take three values: overcast, sunny, or rainy. So we will create a tree kind of structure. So first value will be, we will take as overcast, second value as sunny, third value as rainy, right? Similarly, we will identify like how temperature will be represented. So temperature can take any values, hot, mild, and cool. So we will connect three values, temperature, hot, mild, and cool. Similarly, we connect humidity with normal and high, wind with weak and strong, and plate tennis, it can take only two values because it is an output parameter. We can never assign don't care. So plate tennis, either you can go for plate tennis or not. So why we are actually representing our solution hypothesis by this structure? Because we want to represent our solution hypothesis by binary string. Now what we will do actually, after creating this tree structure, we will check, we will generate one hypothesis. So let us suppose this hypothesis we have taken. If outlook is equal to overcast, temperature is equal to mild, humidity is high and wind is strong, then plate tennis is yes. So how we will represent this hypothesis by a binary number? So definitely outlook is what? Overcast. So what we have taken outlook, outlook will be represented by 3-bit string. So the first bit will be of overcast, second will be of sunny, third value will be for rainy. So because we are talking about overcast only, so we will make it one and all other values will remain zero. So this is how we will represent our outlook, right? Similarly, we go for the temperature. Temperature is mild. Now see the position of the mild. So first position is hot, mild, and cool. So we have to fix this representation for each and every solution. So we can't change it throughout our program. So hot means first position, mild is second, and cool is third one. So for we write temperature, come on. Where is that? Yes. So we will write temperature will be 010 because we want to highlight only mild value. Similarly, if we want to highlight humidity, humidity is what? High. So we have seen humidity, normal or high. So normal is zero, high is one. Wind is weak or strong. So we can see strong. So we will write 01. Plate tennis is yes. So it is one. So the overall hypothesis will be represented in binary in like this. So this is the hypothesis. Hypothesis in one solution of the classification problem. So this will be represented as a binary number like this. And we will identify the fitness of this one. Fitness means how many instances of the data set are satisfying this hypothesis. So only I think one. So the fitness of this solution will be 1/14. Similarly, other hypothesis, look, if outlook is overcast or sunny, now you have two options, right? And if wind is weak, then play tennis is yes. So outlook, here we are considering both the values, overcast or sunny. So we will make those values 1/1. And this value we will make as 0. So temperature is not there, so it means don't care. Don't care means any value is possible. So we will write 1/1/1/1. Similarly, humidity is not there. So we will write humidity as 1/1. And wind is, because wind is weak, so we will represent as 1/0. Plate tennis will be 1. So this will be the hypothesis. And how we calculate the fitness of this hypothesis? So this, for calculating this fitness, we will apply the same method. So we will calculate like when outlook is overcast, what will be the value? When outlook is overcast and wind is weak, the play tennis is yes. And when outlook is sunny, wind is weak, then platinus is yes, so it will satisfy more number of solutions. So let us suppose it is 4 by 40. So in this way, we can represent other hypotheses. So for example, if temperature is hot, then platinus no. It means outlook is not there, don't care. So we will write 1111. Temperature is hot, so we will write 100. Humidity is not there, so 11, wind 11, platinus is 0. And similarly, we can identify the fitness of this solution. So once we have identified the hypothesis, we can identify the fitness of this solution. So I have already told you, like, how can you calculate this one. Now, once you have created initial population and their fitness, you can start with the binary GI application. So why we are working with the binary GI application? Because we want to refine this hypothesis and we want to generate a hypothesis, optimal hypothesis, which can cover entire set of data solutions. So now the things are very easy. So you have to start with the binary hypothesis, right? You have to calculate the fitness values. Okay. And after calculating the fitness value, then you have to apply the selection operator. Then selection operator, after selection operator, you have to go for the crossover, selection and crossover operation. So that you have to repeat it again and again until you get a hypothesis which can cover at least 50% of the data values. So this is how we can apply the binary GI. Just wait. So this is what is that? Okay. So that was the idea, man, like how genetic algorithm can be used for solving classification related problems. You can also use this genetic algorithm in solving other problems, which are related to prediction. Some you can also solve optimization related problems. So whatever problem you want to solve, you can solve with this one. So with this thing, I'm just concluding my lecture. So that is how you can apply genetic algorithm and why that is related to artificial intelligence. And I've already discussed one application. So if you have any queries, you are free to ask. Hello.
Thank you, sir. I request Dr. Tanuja Dupe Madam to continue with the question answer session.
Thank you, sir.
Okay.
Dr. KK Mishra, sir, this is Dr. Tanuja Dupe. There are few questions from the participant side.
Mm-hmm.
The first question is, what is the importance of higher fitness function?
Higher fitness function means what? Higher fitness function means actually what is your objective? Okay. So you need to see, for example, I was discussing a problem where I want to maximize the fitness of Synex, right? I was talking about one problem where I want to maximize the value of Synex, right? Hello.
Hello, sir. Huh? Yes, sir.
So higher fitness function means we want to promote those solutions which are producing higher values, right? So mm-hmm. The probability why we are promoting those solutions, because the probability of finding other solutions nearby those solutions will be very high, as I already told you. For example, I can give you one example. Like if you want to move from one place to another place, for example, if I want to move from Prayagraj to Pune, okay. So if I'm moving it, so I have to check, I just need a direction. So that those higher points will provide you the correct direction, right?
Okay. Yes, sir. Okay. Thank you, sir. The second question is that in binary genetic algorithm,
mm-hmm.
now we are having 2n solutions. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So if I'm taking the value of n as, for example, 5 or
mm-hmm.
or 10, then it is 2n, that much solutions I will be having.
Mm-hmm.
So having such a 2n for higher values, so whether it is going to slow down my system?
Yeah, definitely. If you are taking only 2 to the power 10 number of solutions, it will not actually decrease the efficiency of your system. But actually, when you want to solve complex problem, what you have to do, you have to take more number of solutions, like 2 to the power 40, 2 to the power 100. Mm-hmm. Then your system becomes slow, right?
Okay.
It was just an example, like if for example, if you have to calculate the values of 2 to the power 10 number of solutions, right? Then you have to calculate the fitness value of 2 to the power 10 number of solutions, then the processing will be slow.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thanks a lot. So these are the questions from the participant side. Mm-hmm. From Department of ENTC of Rajashri Shau College of Engineering, I, Dr. Tanuja Dupe, I am very much thankful to Dr. K.K. Mishra, sir, for sparing his time for delivering the expert talk on artificial intelligence. Specifically, sir has already covered and nicely explained about optimization problem using binary genetic algorithm. Thanks a lot. In future also, we hope that if we arrange similar kind of FDPs or expert talk, so we will be looking forward support from your side, sir.
Thank you, ma'am, and thank you for inviting me. It was a nice experience. And you organized it very very beautifully, actually. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot, sir. Over to Pranav, sir. Sir, if you want to do some announcement, you please proceed for the announcement, sir.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, Mishra, sir.
Okay, it's fine.
So, thank you. The next session will start at 2 p.m. Please join 5 minutes earlier. Thank you.